I'm delighted to have our this year's Scolnick Prize winner here at MIT. As Ed Scolnick often cautions me to point out, the prize was actually not established by Ed himself, but was endowed by Merck to honor Ed's many years at Merck, including before he left, president of Merck Research Labs. And every year we pick an outstanding scientist to share this award and to present a lecture to the neuroscience community. Just a very brief bio on Bruce, because it's actually incredibly simple and short. He got his PhD at Rockefeller, and then after a short postdoc in Sweden, he went back to Rockefeller, where he's been ever since. He's head of the Laboratory of Neuroendocrinology and has had various stints as dean and so on all during those years. But is basically, it's a lifelong faculty member of Rockefeller. Bruce, with his interest in the mind-body interaction, was a man way ahead of his time. Nowadays, you know, everyone is aware of the role that stress plays in all sorts of somatic diseases, as well as in many different forms of brain disorders. Practically every form of brain disorder is exacerbated by stress, sometimes brought on by stress and so on. We have a much, much better appreciation of the role that stress plays in the brain, and this has all been work that was pioneered by Bruce. Bruce discovered the corticosteroid receptors in the brain, and as I'm sure you all know, the corticosteroids are released by the adrenal glands, and receptors in the brain take these up, and Bruce showed how neurons in the hippocampus are affected by these hormones, and that in the times of increased stress, the hormones have a negative impact on hippocampal cells. Cells will even shrivel up, and their dendrites will pull back. And it's thought that this is related to some of the negative outcomes of stress. He showed that it affects neurogenesis in the hippocampus. He's also in a parallel line of work, which has actually now come together with the work on stress. He's also been studying the sex hormones, and again, characterize their receptors in the brain and how these activation of these receptors in the brain are modulating neurons in the hippocampus, which are waxing and waning in response to the sex hormones, and is now showing how there's an interaction between the sex hormones and stress hormones and so on. It's an amazingly complex system that is at the heart of so many things that we study in neuroscience and clinicians are studying in the hospitals. He is not confined himself to his work in the laboratory. He's had a long-standing interest in the public implications of the role of stress and its interaction with the brain. He has been an advisor to many agencies, both public and private, that have been formulating policies to manage stress and impact on biology. He has published over 900 research articles. He's a member of the National Academy of Science, the American Academy of Arts and Science, a past president of the Society for Neuroscience, was integral in getting Brain Awareness Week started. He's truly a scientist interested in the public interest, and it is a really honor to have him here today to talk about sex, stress, and the brain. Bruce.
Thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here to receive this award. I'm going to say more about it towards the end. But I want to say at the outset two things. First, that what I have to say about sex may disappoint many of you, but I'm glad you're here. And if I see you walking out, well, that's another matter. And secondly, this weird thing on my ear, some people suggested I say that I had a fight with Mike Tyson, and you ought to see what he looks like. Other people have asked, I'm going to have a pointy ear like Spock. Anyway, that's this too shall pass. So I want to get right into the substance of this and say that as a neuroendocrinologist, I have been in between two areas. Neuroscientists have historically tended to ignore what hormones do to the brain, and I think that's changed. And people interested in the endocrine system and systemic physiology have tended to ignore the brain. It's either above the neck or below the neck. And neuroendocrinology, for good or bad, unites these. And so that's been the subject of our work over many years. The other part of this that you'll hear is that it's not just the hypothalamus that is affected by sex hormones. It's areas of the brain that are involved in cognitive function, emotional control, motor control, and so on. And that's the one of the main themes of the talk. The other theme, starting with this, the classic mechanism of steroid action, which is still very much true, is that these receptors for the steroids are in the cell nucleus, and they regulate gene expression. And this is two classic examples, pioneered by Don Pfaff, who actually started here with his PhD at MIT. Estrogen receptors in the hypothalamus regulate sexual behavior. Glucocorticoid receptors in the paraventricular hypothalamus regulate the stress axis. They help to control the amount of ACTH that's being produced. And these are very much true. But our first sort of foray into this was a serendipitous discovery in the late 1960s that if you adrenalectomize a rat, give it radioactive adrenal steroid, it was taken up and retained in the hippocampus, both in the dentate gyrus and in Ammon's horn, where it concentrates over the cell nucleus, where we know it's bound to either a mineralocorticoid or a glucocorticoid receptor. And studies with electrophysiology and behavior have shown that these receptors mediate a biphasic inverted U-shaped dose response curve to enhance excitability at low doses, to suppress it at high doses, to improve certain aspects of memory at low doses, to suppress them at high doses. This is all in the matter of minutes to hours. These are relatively rapid effects. But you'll hear more as we go on about how chronic stress can affect structural plasticity of the brain. Now, just to remind you about the hippocampus, the famous London cab drivers, studies show a London cabbie's hippocampus lights up in an fMRI machine when he, or sometimes she, imagines the route from one place to another in London. The hippocampus is also important in food-caching birds in the wintertime, and squirrels use their hippocampus to store and locate food. And then it turns out the hippocampus is also a target of sex hormones. Estrogens in females, androgens in males. You'll hear more about that very shortly. And as shown by people like Phil Lanfield and Robert Sapolsky, the hippocampus is very sensitive to age-related changes. It's a sort of canary in the coal mine of wear and tear on the brain with aging. And we'll hear more about this during the talk. The other major revelation in modern neuroscience is that even in the adult brain, dendrites are plastic. They can grow or shrink with experiences aided by hormones, that the turnover of spine synapses is very dynamic, and spine size and shape from recent work of Patrick Hoff and John Morrison is very meaningful, and is rediscovered by Liz Gould and colleagues when she was at Rockefeller. There's a limited amount of neurogenesis in the dentate gyrus of the hippocampus, which can be modulated by experience, and that is in turn modulated by hormones. So the adult brain is a dynamic organ, and you'll hear a lot about that. And then the other major revelation is while the classic action of steroids on the nucleus, steroid receptors, is still very much true, there's a whole array of non-genomic or indirect genomic actions of steroids because the same receptors, gene products, are also found in other parts of the cell. And there are also sometimes receptors, or in some cases, receptors that are different from the classic nuclear receptor that mediate actions on really signaling actions. And you'll hear more about that very shortly. So that aspect of our how we regard hormone action has changed dramatically. So the first part of the talk has to do with estrogens. And this is a list of behavioral features and brain areas that we know are sensitive to estrogen action. Fine motor skills and reaction time, coordination, striatum and cerebellum are targets, excitability and seizures, the hippocampus, autonomic regulation, midbrain and brainstem, memory and attention, hippocampus, prefrontal cortex, pain, spinal cord, amygdala, periaqueductal gray, and neuroprotective effects of estrogens in particular. The way we got into this was the discovery by Catherine Woolley, who was a student, again, when Liz Gould was with us, that in the CA1 region of the hippocampus of a female rat, during the estrus cycle, there's a cyclic buildup of excitatory spine synapses, which when ovulation occurs and a surge of progesterone causes a rapid downregulation of these spines. So there's cyclicity. Spines are formed and then removed. And this can be mimicked by giving ovariectomized rats estrogens. Progesterone would mimic the ovulation effect to cause the downregulation of these spines. The big surprise was that if you blocked NMDA receptors while giving estrogens, it prevented spine formation, which showed that it wasn't just the hormone acting alone, but it involved active synaptic activity involving excitatory amino acids. And there are behavioral studies that show memory-related effects of estrogens and progestins that parallel what the morphology tells us, not only in rodents, but also in primates and in human beings. The other big surprise is that when you look at the CA1 region, we did not see in the pyramidal neurons that make these synapses nuclear estrogen receptors. We saw occasional ones in scattered inhibitory interneurons, but not in the pyramidal neurons themselves. So how do estrogen actions take place? Well, our colleague Terry Milner, who's at Cornell across the street, in a serendipitous experiment, she took antibodies to the classic estrogen receptor and did electron microscopic immunocytochemistry because these things could not be visualized light microscopically as the nuclear receptors could be seen. And what she found was immunoreactivity, specific immunoreactivity in postsynaptic densities, in the spine apparatus, and also in presynaptic terminals in other parts of the cell and mitochondria. And so it looked like there were classic receptors that were expressed outside of the cell nucleus. And using autoradiography with iodinated estradiol, which was injected into the ovariectomized animals, plus or minus an excess of cold steroid, we were able to show at the light microscopic level the same kind of nuclear concentration that we saw with other methods. And then these sections, which had been preserved, fixed so as to preserve the ligand on a putative receptor, were exposed for a year. And there was specific binding associated here with mitochondria, but also in all of the other places that we had been able to see these immunoreactivity using the electron microscopic immunoreactivity. So they are estrogen binding sites, which strengthens their idea that they are receptors. Paul Mermelstein in Minnesota has shown that these receptors, as people have in other cell types, are likely, these non-genomic forms are sequestered in caveoli with caveolar proteins, and they seem to be released by the presence of estrogen in the cell near the membrane to do the various things that we and others are beginning to discover. These other things involve the regulation of acetylcholine release. Here is ER-alpha in cholinergic presynaptic terminals, a Terry Milner study, and involvement in attention and memory processes. And then ER-alpha immunoreactivity in neuropeptide Y terminals, work of Catherine Woolley, who's now at Northwestern, inhibiting perhaps excitability, having a regulatory inhibitory role in seizure susceptibility. So these are two examples of rapid non-genomic actions of estrogens at the presynaptic level. We know that in cell culture, if you apply estrogens, there is the appearance of filopodia-like structures. And this has, along with other evidence, has led to this experiments that have shown that estrogens non-genomically through PI3 kinase stimulate the phosphorylation of LIM kinase, which stimulates the phosphorylation of cofillin, which normally is an inhibitor of actin polymerization, but when it's phosphorylated, the inhibition is removed and it allows actin polymerization that can lead to filopodial extension. And so that represents perhaps the initial phase of contact between a filopodium and a putative presynaptic terminal, and then estrogens come along again, in part through PI3 kinase, and work that Keith Akama and Terry Milner have done, both in vitro and in vivo, have shown that it stimulates the phosphorylation of AKT, which stimulates the phosphorylation of a binding protein that is normally inhibiting translation of messenger RNAs that are there, ready to go. The phosphorylation removes the inhibition, very much like the cofillin phosphorylation, and Keith was able to demonstrate net synthesis of PSD95, which is, of course, is a basic scaffolding building block of a putative spine, the spine part of a synapse. And so we talk about this as synapse formation and maturation, both of which are stimulated in this non-genomic way by estrogens. So what have we learned from this? That classic nuclear estrogen receptors can be found in synapses, spines, dendrites, mitochondria, and glial cells. That estradiol activates signaling pathways leading to actin polymerization, protein synthesis, calcium balance at the mitochondrial level, neurotransmitter release, and also neuronal survival. In collaboration with John Morrison's group at Mount Sinai Medical Center, we know that age results in loss of estrogen-induced synapse formation, and this may be due in part to the fact that the estrogen receptor in the dendrite seems to be lost with aging, as well as the estrogen stimulation of the LIM kinase signaling leading to the actin polymerization. So that it perhaps is a mechanism. That estradiol has neuroprotective effects against stroke, against Parkinson's disease, and Alzheimer's disease. There are developmentally programmed sex differences. You will hear more about these towards the end of the talk, one recent example. And all steroid receptors have membrane-associated forms that activate signaling pathways, which then carries us beyond the classic nuclear actions that we've started out with. So the second part of the talk has to do with stress and focusing first on the hippocampus. As you know, the entorhinal cortex sends input to the dentate gyrus and to the CA3 region. There is a complex feed-forward feedback circuitry, and then the CA3 projection to the CA1 and output to other parts of the brain. This is the part of the hippocampus that's particularly stress sensitive. And we know that the CA3 neurons are vulnerable to damage from seizures or head trauma, particularly from seizures, that with repeated stress, there is the shrinkage of these apical dendrites in a reversible way. So this is not brain damage and may in fact be a way of protecting these cells from permanent irreversible damage. We also know that it's the mossy fiber terminals that release massive amounts of glutamate here in the stratum lucidum that is likely responsible, along with circulating glucocorticoids, for this remodeling. We know that neurogenesis in the dentate gyrus can be reduced by certain types of stress. And in fact, a study a number of years ago by former PhD student, or PhD thesis, Cara Pham, showed that with repeated restraint stress, we had to go out to 6 weeks of daily stress, we could reduce neurogenesis, or at least BRDU labeling of cells. We could shrink the number of granule cells and the volume of the dentate gyrus. It took 6 weeks of stress before we saw a significant effect, but enough stress will actually cause the shrinkage of this part of the hippocampus. We know from other work that exercise will have the opposite effect, stimulating proliferation and actually enlarging this part of the hippocampus. So what about the dendritic shrinkage? We know that it can be mimicked by glucocorticoid treatment, but even that is blocked by dilantin, indicating that some other, probably excitatory amino acids, are involved in the process. And we know that with acute restraint stress, from this work by Lowy, Galt, and Yamamoto in 1993, that with microdialysis, there is a release and elevation of extracellular glutamate during the restraint stress, which is not present when the animal is adrenalectomized. So there's some interaction between extracellular glutamate and adrenal secretions. And in fact, we know that chronic stress-induced remodeling can be prevented by blocking glucocorticoid synthesis, but also by blocking NMDA receptors, by using lithium, dilantin, certain kinds of antidepressants, benzodiazepine, which probably enhances inhibitory tone, and by a deficiency or overexpression of BDNF. So it appears there is a floor and a ceiling within which this kind of adaptive plasticity is taking place. And in fact, within the CA3 region, and a particular there is, with chronic stress, there's an elevation of glutamate transporter expression in both neurons and in the surrounding astrocytes, indicating that the glutamate release is inducing the transporter, which is removing the glutamate. And interestingly enough, an antidepressant called tianeptine prevents this increase, which suggests that it may also be preventing the excessive glutamate release. So again, illustrating the importance of other cells, namely the astrocytes, besides the neurons. Now, we've been interested in gene expression, as many people are, and in a collaboration with Ron DeClute and Nicole Dotson, we've looked at chronically stressed rats compared to naive rats given an acute challenge with glucocorticoids, because Dotson and DeClute find that it's that acute corticosteroid challenge that induce patterns of gene expression quite dramatically as a sort of test bed. And using a laser microdissection and gene chips, what has been found so far is that comparing acute cort for a naive animal and acute cort treatment for a stressed animal is they have about the same number of genes that are either turned on or repressed. This happens to be in the dentate gyrus, which is one of the more active areas. And yet, if we look at the qualitative nature of these genes, they're only about less than half are the same. There is a large percentage of the genes that are different between the acutely stressed and the chronically stressed hippocampus. And so we become interested in what these are, but in the process, teamed up with David Alice, because I was a student of Vincent Alfrey and Alfred Mirsky and became interested many decades ago in the role of histones, modification of nuclear proteins. Coming back to this with David Alice, who's current leader in this area at Rockefeller, looking at modifications that include acetylation, methylation, ubiquitination, suomalylation, and phosphorylation. We certainly haven't studied all of these by any means, but in a study by Richard Hunter working with Don Pfaff, my down-the-hall neighbor, and David Alice, we found that the a mark for H3K9 trimethyl is is markedly enhanced in dentate gyrus in the CA3 region by acute restraint stress. Keep that in mind. This is acute stress in a naive animal. In fact, the acute stress turns on the messenger RNA for one of the methylating enzymes transiently, because it's found right away but not 45 minutes later. The interesting finding, fascinating finding, is that if you then do chronic stress, by the time you get out to 21 days and then do an acute stress on the 21st day, this repressive mark is lost. And so we're trying to understand what this means, and this is very much an ongoing story. So using a CHIP chromatin immunoprecipitation sequence seq type analysis, Richard Hunter working with the people at Rockefeller doing this kind of analysis have found that in the repressed DNA, so repression results in an enrichment of these interspersed nuclear element DNAs, including retrotransposons, a whole series of things that I frankly never heard of before, and now have to become very much interested in. Some of them showed a tenfold or more enrichment, and Richard has also shown that the RNA expression under these conditions is actually reduced. So there is a repression of the expression of these. And yet, what he's found is that the repression is lost after chronic stress, as is the histone mark indication of repression as well. So the suggestion of this is that acute stress reduces perhaps the potential for genomic instability, either for good or ill, but this is lost after chronic stress. And we're trying to understand, we will try to understand the meaning of this in the future, because if we then go back to our inverted U-shaped function, we know that acute stress over short time frames enhances excitability, as I said earlier, that acute higher level stress can have an inhibitory effect on excitability and certain kinds of memory, that chronic stress leading to what we call adaptive plasticity, which is largely reversible, at least in the young brain. But then the question is, what kind of memory is there in the tissue that may reflect either protection or some kind of destabilization that could, over time or with second and third insults, lead to permanent irreversible damage? And this relates to the whole idea of weathering or chronic stress effects on the aging brain, which is another future direction. And then finally, just to remind you that with a seizure, stroke, or head trauma, there's excitotoxicity, which is made worse by adrenal steroids acting in concert with the excitatory amino acids. So let's go then to talk about some of these non-genomic actions. We know that glucocorticoids have direct genomic effects. They have indirect genomic effects through membrane-associated glucocorticoid receptors, sometimes often synergizing with second messenger systems as well. We also know from the work on many cell types that glucocorticoid receptors translocate into mitochondria, where at physiologic levels they help with the buffering of calcium. So they can actually be neuroprotective, but too much glucocorticoids actually can cause this protection to be lost, and the cell becomes more vulnerable, as Robert Sapolsky originally proposed with his glucocorticoid endangerment idea. So again, there's a biphasic effect at the mitochondrial level. We know from work from Marianne Joles in the Netherlands that mineralocorticoid receptors are mysteriously associated with the membrane, where they respond to higher levels of corticosteroids and facilitate the release of glutamate. But at the same time, the glucocorticoids stimulate the production of endocannabinoids, which can feed back through the CB1 receptor system to inhibit the release of glutamate, or in some cell types, to inhibit the release of GABA. So we have both feed-forward and feedback mechanisms at the non-genomic level, as well as these genomic and indirect genomic effects. So indeed, the story of glucocorticoid actions has become much more complicated and much more interesting in many ways. This is an electron micrograph of bona fide glucocorticoid immunoreactivity and postsynaptic densities of neurons in the amygdala, just to show that, like estrogen receptors, you can see GR also at this non-genomic level. Don't know what this means functionally. And then we have to just briefly consider these endocannabinoids, because they're fascinating, and through the work of Matt Hill, who's has been a postdoctoral fellow with us and is now taking up a position at the University of Calgary, we're shown in this particular fairly recent study that an acute bolus of glucocorticoids within 10 minutes causes an increase in the amygdala of anandamide and a borderline significant increase in the other endocannabinoid 2AG. And Matt and others have shown that both endocannabinoids contain HPA function by reducing basal levels of ACTH and also promoting the shutoff and habituation of the response when you apply repeated stress. So they play a very important containing role. We know that from work done by Matt Hill with Cecilia Hillard at Medical College of Wisconsin, that a mouse that lacks one of the degradative enzymes for anandamide in particular, FA, actually is very calm and unresponsive to stressors, because like a classic sort of pothead that's overexposed to endocannabinoid or to cannabis, it has sort of completely blitzed the brain, so it doesn't really respond in any meaningful way to stressors. On the other hand, the CB1 knockout, not having this particular receptor, leads to a very anxious and even without added stress, and the dendrites in the hippocampus and prefrontal cortex, which are caused to shrink by stress, actually are already shorter and less branched, even without any applied stress. So this then is a segue into talking about the fact that while in the hippocampus and also in the medial prefrontal cortex, there is dendritic shrinkage with repeated stress. In the amygdala, basolateral amygdala, and orbital frontal cortex, there is growth of dendrites. And many of you know Shona Chatterjee, who spends some of his time here at MIT, who really showed initially in the basolateral amygdala this phenomenon of dendritic growth and new spine formation with repeated immobilization stress. And we are collaborating with him. But one of the findings, getting back to the CB1 knockout mouse, is that in the basolateral amygdala of a CB1 knockout, even without any applied stress, the dendritic branches our dendrites are longer. And if you apply chronic stress, the wild type indeed shows the increased length, as Shona showed in his rat studies. The CB1 knockout shows an even greater increase. So there's not a ceiling effect, but the direction is always to increase dendritic length and to increase anxiety in these animals. In an ongoing study with the Chatterjee lab, Shona showed that a single immobilization of a rat with nothing in between leads 10 days later to an increased anxiety and new spines in the basolateral amygdala. The dendrites don't get longer, but there's new spines, and the animals become a lot more anxious in an open, elevated plus maze. But the amazing finding that we're now getting ready for publication is that exposure to a modest stress or to elevated levels of glucocorticoids at the time of this initial immobilization prevents the loss of the induction of spines or the increase in anxiety. And this seems in many ways to be counterintuitive, because we would tend to say, oh, it's the stress response that's causing this. But in fact, the human literature on PTSD has shown epidemiologically that low levels of glucocorticoids at the time of trauma, and these people are not Addisonian, but low normal levels leads to increased risk for PTSD, that supplemental cort in people with low normal levels in a clinical research setting, people undergoing open heart surgery, reduces later PTSD symptoms, and animal models and a recent human study giving cortisol to people who've had an auto accident, some traumatic event, seems to reduce the incidence of PTSD. So it illustrates the fact that cortisol may actually be a protective agent in this case and may actually appears to oppose the stress effects in the amygdala. I don't have time to go into it, but we know that BDNF is an important facilitator of plasticity, both in the amygdala and in the hippocampus, that if you have too much or too little, you do not see the plasticity that I've described for both the amygdala and the hippocampus. And in work with Sid Strickland's lab, we know that tissue plasminogen activator is a secreted molecule in excitatory terminals that is required for stress-induced loss of spines in the hippocampus. And if you don't have TPA because of a genetic deletion, you do not see stress-induced loss of spines, and you do not see stress-induced impairment of the rate of spatial memory acquisition. To move on then from the amygdala very briefly to talk about the prefrontal cortex, which is very important and connected to the amygdala in reciprocal ways. We know from work with the John Morrison, Patrick Hoff group, work by Connor Liston, that chronic stress of the same kind I've described that causes the amygdala to get larger, the hippocampus to shrink, causes neurons in the medial prefrontal cortex to shrink. Neurons in the orbital frontal cortex actually expand their dendrites, very much like in the basolateral amygdala. Whoops. And in recent work by Eric Bloss with John Morrison and our group, we've shown that young rats show a dendritic remodeling with chronic stress in the medial prefrontal cortex. And if you allow 3 weeks of recovery, remember I said these effects are reversible, there's full recovery of dendritic length. But if you're a middle-aged rat, you see only partial recovery in that 3 week window after the stress has ended. And an old 20-month-old rat shows the same degree of shrinkage, but no recovery in that 3 week period. Whether it'll recover longer, over longer periods of time, we don't yet know. Chronic circadian disruption, work of Ilya Karatsourios, who's an expert in circadian biology, has shown if you put a mouse into a 10-10 light-dark cycle that its biological clock cannot adjust to, a 20-hour day, that neurons in the medial prefrontal cortex become shorter and less branched. And in addition, there are metabolic disruptions in that over a month or two, the animals become heavier, and they have higher insulin and leptin levels, indicating that they're becoming insulin and leptin resistant. So it's an illustration of what we think is sort of an animal model of shift work and perhaps chronic jet lag. Some of the other things that we've found in this collaboration is that spine size and shape changes with repeated stress. And some of this is very much related to age-related loss of plasticity. We also know that while chronic stress of a younger animal causes a reversible loss of D1 receptor signaling for LTP and a reversible decrease in total dendritic length, the recovery is heterotypic in that while the dendrites are lost with stress more distally from the cell body, the ones that regrow in the recovery condition are more proximal to the cell body. And this suggests that these neurons are not the same, simply going back to the same way they were before. And then, since we are interested in sex differences, we know that females show a different pattern of remodeling of their dendrites. They do not show the same decrease in response to stress that the males show. And Yet the female, if as Rebecca Shansky did, retrograde tracing from the amygdala back to the prefrontal cortex, those prefrontal cortical neurons that project to the amygdala show an expansion of their dendritic branches that is dependent on their having estrogens on board. So you need estrogens on board, and then chronic stress will cause the opposite. Males do not show this change at all. Increased dendritic branching of cells that project back to the amygdala. We don't know the functional significance of this, but it suggests that there are probably subtle sex differences in many parts of the brain that may have functional implications. So finally, to say a little bit of a word about some of the translational implications of this, if we look at, just to remind you, that the amygdala is involved in emotions, fear, and anxiety, and aggression. It also turns on the cortisol and autonomic response to stress. And in the basolateral amygdala, neurons undergo hypertrophy. In the hippocampus, which is involved in memory as well as shutting off cortisol secretion, these neurons undergo atrophy. In the prefrontal cortex, medial, involved in decision-making, working memory, top-down control of impulsive behavior, autonomic and cortisol regulation as well, there's atrophy with repeated stress. Now, if these things happened in the human brain, you'd expect to see many functions, both cognitive, emotional, and physiologic, altered. In studies on the human hippocampus, we know there is cyclicity of the hippocampal volume during the human menstrual cycle. We know that in relation to disease states, Cushing's disease, type 2 diabetes, depression, post-traumatic stress disorder, and mild cognitive impairment and Alzheimer's disease are associated with a smaller hippocampus. We know for Cushing's disease there can be some at least partial reversal if the hypercortisolemia is corrected. There's some limited evidence of correction of volume changes in major depression. But even without disease states, chronic stress is associated with a smaller hippocampus. Chronic inflammation also with a smaller hippocampus. Chronic jet lag is associated with a smaller hippocampus. And there's a study of air crews showing that if an air crew has 2 weeks or longer to recover from international flights, they do not show this. Lack of exercise with a smaller hippocampus, but then there's some exciting work from Keith Erickson and Art Kramer's group that increased exercise, even walking 60 minutes a day, 5 out of 7 days a week, actually will enlarge the volume of the human hippocampus. There's evidence that low self-esteem is associated with a smaller hippocampus and lower socioeconomic status. There's also evidence that intensive learning will increase the volume of the hippocampus over a 3 to 6 month period. So it can go in both directions. With regard to the prefrontal cortex, the same Connor Liston, who did the rat studies, teamed with BJ Casey at Cornell Medical School, and looked at medical students studying for the board exam using a perceived stress scale, which essentially tests how much in control of your daily life you feel. They used a test of cognitive flexibility to define with fMRI a circuit for this particular task. And this circuit involves the prefrontal cortex. And as this says here, they found that higher scores on the perceived stress scale, the more stressed out these people were, predicted poor mental flexibility, and it also predicted a reduced functional connectivity in this already defined brain circuit. The good news is that after taking the exam and a vacation, these effects disappear. So the young brain is resilient. What about older brains? I'm not so sure. So what we're talking about then, have talked about, is this idea of the plasticity of the adult brain. Brain circuitry responds to experiences and hormones. Hormone actions synergize with other mediators. That's extremely important. They don't work by themselves. There appears to be a loss of resilience in the aging brain, And very likely in chronic anxiety and mood disorders, there's also a loss of resilience. The brain gets locked into a certain state and has to be treated with other external means. Remembering that the same mediators that are involved, like cortisol and so on, in helping the brain adapt can also turn against the brain when they're overused or dysregulated and lead to pathophysiology. And that's behind this concept I haven't really talked about of allostasis and allostatic load. We have to consider sex differences and sex hormones, because the whole brain is a target of sex hormones, and sex differences that are developmentally programmed are there and undoubtedly contribute to differences in how male and female brains handle the same situations with perhaps different strategies to achieve similar outcomes. Top-down interventions such as physical activity are extraordinarily important. And finally, the social environment that we live in is extremely important for how our brains function, and through the neuroendocrine and autonomic system for how the body functions. So you may have started out thinking that the last thing I want to know is that 30 different hormones are stimulated when I feel stressed. Mother Nature put them there to do good things. And I've tried to emphasize the positive side. But at the same time, the overuse or dysregulation of these systems leads to pathophysiology. And as this statement says, we have the capacity to prevent as well as treat through individual behavior and through policies of our society, both government and the public sector. This is sort of an overview of this. I've been involved with the MacArthur Foundation Research Network on Socioeconomic Status and Health. Tomorrow I'll go over to visit the National Scientific Council on the Developing Child and Jack Schoenkopf and give another talk. I'm also a member of the IOM Board on Children, Youth, and Families, and we're all interested in, especially in these two organizations, in understanding how early life interventions can have beneficial effects to prevent the development of very serious disorders that affect our lives, as shown in the famous Adverse Childhood Experiences study. So I'm very appreciative to MIT and the McGovern Institute for this award. And I think what our experience in science has been, it's from serendipity. Nobody cared about glucocorticoids in the hippocampus when we first found it. Nobody really knew what it meant. But it's told us, as I said at the beginning, that neuroscientists have to consider the impact of systemic physiology, hormones, and other mediators. And our understanding and prevention and treatment of disease has to consider the brain as the central organ of stress and adaptation. Because, as I've said, the social as well as the physical environment has a huge impact, in part through our brains, on our ability to lead a healthy and productive life. Now, there are many people who played a very important role in my career, and I could not go finish the talk without acknowledging Alfred Mirsky. I hold a professorship in his name. He was also the one who taught me about environmental regulation of gene expression before there was a lot of interest in this. Vince Alfrey, with his interest in nuclear proteins and what we now call epigenetics, control of gene control with basic proteins. Holger Hedane, with whom I studied in Sweden, taught me a lot about the neuroanatomy and introduced me to the hippocampus. Neil Miller, my mentor at Rockefeller when I went back there as a young faculty member. Don Pfaff, who I met at that time, who's done pioneering work on sex steroids and especially sex behavior. Fernando Nottebohm and his pioneering studies of neuroplasticity, especially neurogenesis in the songbird brain. And then colleagues and collaborators, many of whose names I've already mentioned in the course of telling you about some of the things that are going on, and include colleagues both at Rockefeller and elsewhere. a list of former students and postdocs who have taught me certainly more than I've probably taught them, but it's been a wonderful group of people to be associated with, one of the joys of doing science, and current colleagues and collaborators that, again, are I haven't had a chance to actively acknowledge with their names, including my wife, Karen Bullock, who has her own neuroimmune physiology program, which is uncovering exciting things about the brain's immune system, and who also happened to take a picture of another important advisor who keeps me calm and relieves my own stress. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bruce. That was really incredible.
Thank you.
We'll have time for a couple of questions. We have a reception afterwards, so we can have a couple of questions now. Martha.
Could you hear me?
Early life stress.
Yes, and this work that Meany's group has recently published on real dysregulation of the glucocorticoid receptor. That's all been done in rodents, but have people been tracking kids in stressful situations to find out when it's reversible?
Well, that's a very good question too. I mean, in the first place, just to The Meany story, Meany and Moshe Ziff, have taken a very important model that's been developed by people like Seymour Levine, shown that if you separate pups from the mom for 10 minutes a day and put them back with mom, she is much more, most mothers are much more maternal, and the more licking and grooming, the more these animals, as they grow up, become calm and laid back and so on. That's good, by the way, in a safe environment, but in a dangerous environment, they may get eaten a lot quicker. So it has a certain kind of adaptive significance. They've also shown that the females become better mothers, and there is transgenerational transmission, probably through behavior, not through epigenetic mechanisms in the genome, which also apparently are beginning to be shown. So that's the story. And they have also shown in a very interesting paper in, I think, Nature Neuroscience several years ago, that there are, in people who've had a history of abuse, if they actually look, and well, I haven't said, the methylation of certain regulatory elements in the glucocorticoid receptor promoter that determines the expression of the glucocorticoid receptor in the hippocampus is altered by methylation. And in fact, maternal care seems to cause a demethylation of the promoter, so more glucocorticoid receptor can be expressed. And if you have more glucocorticoid receptor, your brain is able to adapt more. It's able to do the good things that glucocorticoids do, maybe better able to do some of the bad things it does, but it seems to have an adaptive value. And what they showed in their Nature Neuroscience paper in white blood cells taken, or no, it was in brain tissue, taken from autopsy cases, that there was something similar with the promoter. So it's a wonderful demonstration of how you can translate. Now, there's so much in between that we don't understand yet, but it's shown how we can take something relatively simple like that and begin to see how it can play out in a much more complex situation. Now, if we then go to the adverse childhood experiences studies of Robert Onda and Vincent Felitti, they developed a scale to determine the amount of adversity that range from, you know, the crowding of the household, the amount of harsh language, the amount of physical abuse, sexual abuse, many things in the environment, and their ACE score predicted increased levels of behavioral abnormalities, and also physical abnormalities like increased incidence of heart disease, and overall there appears to be increased incidence of inflammatory tone and the like in kids who've been abused, even by simply harsh language, their parents yelling at them early in life. Now the ACE study was done not in a poor population, in the Kaiser Permanente Health System in California, which illustrates the fact that this permeates our society, and not just poor people, but it's people in the middle. And we know how people now, with the economic issues and many other issues, are feeling stressed. And in some cases, they're transmitting this to their kids. And so one of the goals of the Nurse Family Partnership, of the Harlem Children's Own Baby College, is to improve the interaction between parents and children to try to cut off at the pass and allow kids to be healthier, because our society pays an enormous cost for this abuse and neglect.
So I don't want to take up the whole question period, but so the Romanian study on orphans suggested that if a child was adopted after 2.5 to 3 years,
right,
they were irreversible.
Yeah, Chuck Nelson's led the,
and
Megan Gunner.
Is there any work on rodents that gives you an idea of how that susceptibility or recoverability is?
Well, I think the way that I think most people think about it is that there is a, shall we say, a critical or vulnerable period. And when brain circuits are developed in a certain way, what you can do with therapy and later in life, and we obviously have to continue, is to cause the brain to compensate.
Right.
You're not necessarily going to undo those original, but you can compensate, whether it's pharmaceutically or behaviorally. And that, of course, takes immense amounts of effort and expense, which is one of the reasons why we should prevent it in the first place, but we shouldn't stop. But in terms of when the critical window is, of course, the rodent develops in a completely different way, and I think we would say that certainly the first 14 days of postnatal life, we can talk about it later, the Regina Sullivan phenomenon of when the amygdala gets turned on, so animals switch from becoming attracted to a noxious stimulus to becoming repelled by it. And it's very important when the amygdala actually gets turned on to become this way. And, you know, I can tell you, anybody who's interested more about that. Yes?
How are these hormonal plastic changes correlated with chronic pain conditions?
Well, that in itself, how long do you want to stay around? One of the paradoxes of chronic pain is that there are circuitry changes both centrally in the amygdala, the spinal cord in particular, and actually glucocorticoids and excitatory amino acids seem to drive the plasticity that leads to this increased chronic pain. And yet when people treat chronic pain, they often give massive doses of glucocorticoids. It's a paradox. I don't begin to understand how these two things can be true, but certainly they're in central pain conditions. I think we're beginning to realize that there is sensitization of brain structures, including the amygdala and other places, that leads to an increased response to stimuli that people who don't have this would not respond to. There also are peripheral mechanisms as well. It's a very complicated area, and I don't even begin to understand all of the nuances of it. But it's definitely, the plasticity maybe for bad things is involved. I mean, for example, this BDNF, which is wonderful in terms of perhaps helping adaptive plasticity, also facilitates the development of kindled seizures. And in a bad situation, it can facilitate the wrong kind of plasticity, which can have adverse effects.
Thank
and
you.
Maybe also in the case of the pain. There's one there, and then,
Can you elaborate on certain hypotheses about the interactions between chronic stress and how they wear out acute stress responses?
Are some of the thoughts on the interactions between chronic stress and its effect on the acute stress responses a wear and tear or an adaptive mechanism, or what are some of the bigger picture hypotheses?
Well, that's exactly the puzzle I presented when I talked about this, chromosomal repression. I mean, there is evidence, for example, Cheryl Conrad at the University of Arizona has shown that right after a period of chronic stress, if you apply ibotenic acid locally into the hippocampus and you compare the response of a chronically stressed animal with an acutely not previously stressed animal, that the damage is worse in the chronically stressed animal. Now, we have a study that we're just getting ready for publication where we have actually, there's a polysialated neural cell adhesion molecule is expressed in areas of the brain that show plasticity, neurogenesis, dendritic remodeling. And we thought, Trudy McCall was a student, thought that if we could, and this enzyme that removes the PSA from NCAM gets rid of this molecule, and other evidence suggests that the plasticity would be lost. And in fact, what happened is that unexpectedly, the dendrites in the hippocampus expand almost uncontrollably. We apply stress, and we still see the dendritic shrinkage. But the dendrites of the chronically stressed PSA NCAM treated animal are actually still longer than that of any control. And so that completely blew our minds. But then another postdoc in the lab took it one step further and used excitotoxic lesions and found, lo and behold, that yes, longer dendrites make the brain a lot more sensitive to irreversible damage. So that fits with our hypothesis that shrinkage of dendrites may be a somewhat protective mechanism, but it blew away all of our ideas about how the PSA NCAM system works. So I think the question is, I suspect that there is a protective advantage for doing these things, but at the same time, the brain cells have a memory, quote unquote, that makes them more vulnerable. I mean, the whole idea of weathering with aging, of the fact that what happens to you will, you know, build upon itself over time and make the brain more vulnerable, like you can't bounce back like we showed after chronic stress in a middle-aged or older animal. All of these things, it's a mixed bag. There's some good and there's some cumulative effect that we haven't really uncovered yet. One there or either. No, Steve.
All right, so if this is the last question, let me ask you a somewhat unfair question.
All right.
So the two disorders that are most associated with hippocampus and glucocorticoids are post-traumatic stress disorder, which is a very big problem for the United States right now. With returning soldiers, and major depression. And there are, you know, the data is a bit too thinner than we would like, but there are two conflicting stories out there. One is that a small hippocampus is a risk for PTSD, right, based on twins, one of whom served in combat and one didn't, and that people with PTSD, a New York story actually, have low glucocorticoids, which has never seemed fully understandable to me, based on my reading of your work. Whereas in major depression, there's increasing evidence that there may actually be progressive brain atrophy. I think that's pretty convincing, related to the length of episodes. So the reason it's unfair is because, you know, you have short time to answer it. But what are glucocorticoids really doing to the hippocampus? Is your reading of the literature that glucocorticoids, I think everyone would agree they're high in major depression. Do you think they're really low in PTSD? Lots of people with PTSD go on to have depression. Can you kind of tie together this seemingly very important but still messy literature?
Yeah, I hear you. Well, I think in terms of hippocampal volume, I think both things are true. A smaller hippocampus, which may actually be related to low self-esteem, which may be related to early childhood abuse, is a risk factor for PTSD. But at the same time, once the trauma happens, I think the hippocampus can get even smaller. And I think that glucocorticoids facilitate dendritic shrinkage, loss of spines in the hippocampus. But remember what I said about the amygdala. Much to our surprise, they may actually be opposing the increase that leads to increased anxiety. And I think that my best reading of the PTSD literature is that people who have low normal levels of corticosteroids at the time of the trauma are more vulnerable to develop that, perhaps through the amygdala mechanism. But if you look, there are studies that that follow people who have PTSD and look at urinary cortisol and other things. They go through their daily lives irritated by the world around them. They're producing a lot more cortisol. So they're producing a lot more because they are out of sync with their world. And yet when you remind them of the trauma, stimuli of the trauma, their HP axis shuts down. We know that that's true, the dissociation and other things associated with. So I think also there both things are true, but in a different sort of sense in each case. And we got to get a little more sophisticated about how we think about it.